Do you know what's a math teacher's favorite kind of tree? Geometry!
Hey math lovers, let's go over 1.10 introduction. Our learning targets are standards for mathematical content. Interpret key features of a quadratic graph and tables and calculate the average, something called the average rate of change. Okay, how can I meet this standard? I can find the domain range and average rate of change of a quadratic functions found in the real world. All right, let's go ahead and try this warm up. You have two functions here, f of x and g of x. And in these five questions here, they are asking you to evaluate each of these. So what is f of 3? Here is my hint. If you put f of x over this, they're basically telling you that x is equal to 3. X is equal to 3. Press pause, and then when you want to see the solutions or you want me to do it with you step by step, go ahead and press play. All right, so I have two functions here. Let's call this f of x, the green one, and g of x, the yellow one. Okay, so you'll notice that the first problem has an f. So I'm just gonna copy that. F of x equals negative 6x plus 2. And here, all we have to do is a substitution. We said that x is equal to 3, so I'm gonna put that every time I see x. So instead of writing x, we're gonna write 3. So f of 3 equals negative 6. And every time we do a substitution, you put in parentheses. And here I'm gonna use PEMDAS, so the order of operations. And this is telling me that multiplication goes first, left to right, right? Before addition and subtraction. So negative 6 times 3 will give me negative 18 plus 2. And if you just simplify that, that'll give me negative 16. Okay, so I just want to talk about how this is essentially an ordered pair. This is your x value. So x equals 3. X equals 3. Think of an ordered pair. And then this is basically saying f of x equals negative 16. At 3, it's negative 16. That just means your y value is negative 16. So that would be an ordered pair, and you can graph that, okay? All right, let's go ahead and try the next one. So our next problem is in yellow because I have a G and this one has a G. So I'm just gonna copy that. And I'm gonna write it right below it. G of X equals X squared minus 2X plus 5. And hopefully you recognize that your X value is what? Negative 4. So every X value, I'm gonna write negative 4. Now this is super important because this is where students will make the mistake, is not using your parentheses when there is a substitution. So right here, all of x is negative 4, in parentheses, then you square it. Same thing, parentheses, and then plus 5. Now we just need to simplify and use order of operations. So I'm going to use PEMDAS, I'm going to use the exponent first. And so negative 4 times negative 4 is positive 16. Remember, this is multiplication here, so that's negative 2 times negative 4 is positive 8, and that is 5. Remember, that does not read negative 2 minus 4. That would be incorrect. So if you just add all those up, 24 plus 5, I get 29. Remember, the order pair would just be negative 4 comma 29 as your order pair. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Double check the answers are correct. Okay, this one tells me the function of F, which we said was what color? Green. But here's something different. It has n minus 2 in there. But let's just write out the function for x. F of x equals negative 6x plus 2. And we said that every time we see what's in the parentheses, so your x value, instead of writing x, we're going to write n minus 2. N minus 2. So no longer am I writing x, I'm writing n minus 2 with my yellow highlight. N minus 2 goes right in there. Okay, so what's different about this one is you have a variable, which is fine. You don't have to be scared of it. And I'm still going to use PEMDAS, so there's no exponents. In the parentheses, I cannot put n minus 2 together, they're not like terms. So right here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to distribute. This is multiplication, and I got to distribute everything inside. If I bring back a boba for my kids, you know, I can't bring it for one kid, I got to bring it for everybody. So everybody inside gets it. So negative 6n, negative 6 times negative 2 is positive 12. And then plus 2. You could have done an in-between step in there if that's helpful for you. You could have done something like this. Negative 6 times n, and then negative 6 times a negative 2 plus 2. And then you'll see that how those come into play. And then I just need to combine like terms here, so that will give me a negative 6n plus 14. So in this problem, those aren't an ordered pair, but when I put in the into the function n minus 2, it comes out as negative 6n plus 14. All right, let's go ahead and try number 4. Number 4 is, what letter we got here? We got yellow. Okay, why am I choosing the yellow function? Because it had a g in front. Now pay attention, this g only represents this part right here. Okay, so let's just write it out first. I have g of x equals x squared plus, sorry, that's a minus, 2x plus 5. And I'm going to go ahead and highlight this part here, the plus 2, because a lot of students will forget that. So you can just write a plus 2 at the end. So let's summarize what we did. G of negative 1 is going to happen here in this yellow box, and the red there, we can't forget. Okay, so we have every x value is negative 1. Every x value is negative 1. Let's write this in now. So I have G negative 1. Remember, every x value you must put in parentheses. It's a substitution. You just can't forget it. Okay, I'm just going to go simplify order of operations. I see parentheses and exponents. Negative 1 times negative 1. That's what it means, right? So you have positive 1. Remember, this is multiplication here. So that's negative 2 times negative 1, which is 2. Positive 2. Plus 5, and don't forget that, plus 2. And so if I finish the problem, 1 plus 2 plus 5 plus 2 gives me 10. And that would be our answer. Negative g of negative 1 equals 10. And that's just a fancy way of saying the order pair, negative 1 comma 10. And then our last problem is going to combine two of them. So we had in yellow the g's, whoops, that's not yellow, the g there, so let's go ahead and write out that one. G of x is x squared, and you can do this two ways. You can do it like all together, you can do it separate. I'm happy with this. Let's separate it. Let's just do two problems in one, okay? So I have g of x equals x squared minus 2x plus 5. And I keep forgetting what color we chose for the f is green. Then over here, let's write f of x equals negative 6x plus 2. Let's finish this one first. So every x value is 2. So g of 2 equals 2 squared minus 2 times 2 plus 5. And I'm going to do the exponents, so that would be 4 minus 4 plus 5. 4 minus 4 is 0, so g of 2 equals 5. And then over here, we're going to do the same thing. Okay, now, if you get confused, you can just write above it, f of negative 3. So that means every x value here is going to be negative 3. Every time I see x, I'm going to write negative 3. So I see an x, let's write negative 3. Order of operations, so multiplication before, remember this is not 6 minus 3, it's 6 times, because in between negative 6 and x there is no subtraction sign, so positive 18, caught myself, whoa, and this would basically be 20. Okay, so to marry these two, I just have 20 and a 5, which is positive, so you can write that your answer is going to be 25. F of negative 3 plus g of 2 equals
25.
All right, let's go into our law.
What do footballs, long jumpers, and softballs have in common? They all follow the same rules of motion, but who makes those rules? The parabola. The parabola is what goes in the blank, so parabolas are good sports. The paths of projectiles vary in height, and distance traveled. So you can kick a football really high in the air, or maybe you want to go long, or kind of a perfect one. However, projectiles follow a parabolic path. It looks like a U. And here's a really big one right here. At its maximum height, a projectile's vertical motion is momentarily stopped. Okay, so I would say going from left to right, it's increasing and it stops right there. And then you go down, decreasing. So you think about it, think about those roller coasters. I think that, is it Extreme Scream or something like that at Knott's Berry Farm? And it kind of, you do feel like almost weightless at the very top there. Now, if you ignore air resistance and gravity is the only force acting on this projectile. And then the force of gravity of Earth is constantly 9.8 meters per second squared. So it is the same, which is kind of cool, because if you drop a penny from a very tall place, or you drop like a brick, they will actually fall at the same rate. I wonder who created that formula. Every projectile starts with a push. It needs kind of energy. And the initial force launches this projectile. So let's just say, like my kids like to kick the soccer ball in the front yard, or a soccer ball, right? You need to actually put the energy into it. A projectile launched from the ground takes the same amount of time traveling to its maximum height as it does traveling from there to the ground. So if you kick this apple from over here, and you kick it here, it's saying the distance right here is the midpoint, or we'll talk about later is the line of symmetry, and then it's the same amount of time. So if it took like 2 seconds to get up here, then it's going to take 2 seconds to fall down. I apologize, I don't understand your name. Galina Chitikova holds the women's long jump record of 7.52 meters, 24 feet, 8 inches. That's roughly the length of two cars. Two cars goes in the fill blank there. I was like, no way. She can go that far. That is amazing. The highest basketball toss The highest basket toss of a cheerleader reached a height of 5.50 meters, or 18 feet is what you need to put in there, 18 feet, which is pretty crazy. That's almost twice the height of a basketball hoop. And of course, the GOAT, Michael Jordan, is legendary for his amazing slam dunks. He stayed in the air up to 0.92 seconds. That's why they call him Air Jordan. All right, hopefully you were able to play around with this. Let's go ahead and set the default to 1. Can you just click a number? Oh yeah, you can just type in 1. Okay, so if you have a graph, you could, you know, blue is kind of like the parent function, and they're not the same. Mother function, they call it sometimes. And then the green one is like your kids, like my kids. They look like me, not exactly, right? But I told you to put green there, so you can turn this off by just clicking on that. And then it says, what happens when A is positive? So if I go here towards positive numbers, I notice it's getting skinnier. And then if I go negative, what happens? It goes down. So this one would be positive. That would be up. And when it goes negative or less than zero, that's what numbers less than zero means. It means negative, it's gonna go down. And we said this one was up. Okay, set to default, so that means put them all back at 1. Isn't that song, cheesy love song, back at 1. Moving the b value, what is the y-intercept of this function? So here's the y-intercept right now. It is 1, and it's telling us move the b value. So what happens to the b value? So I notice when the b value moves, when we move the b value, the y-intercept stays the same, but the graph moves. Movies moves. What happened when it was positive? Alright, so when it's negative, it moves towards the right, and when it was positive, it moves to the left. When B was positive, it moves to the left. When B is less than zero, or negative number, the graph moves, can't spell, graph to the right. So if we set it back to the default, it says, for number 7, what happens to the graph as the value of C changes? So if I go positive, it goes where? Up. And if it's negative, it's going down. So did the graph go vertically up and down, or horizontally left and right? It went vertically.
All right, let's go over the, these are the answers for the launch. Let's go under Explore now. Go ahead and click on that. And you have this Desmos kind of graph. The green graph represents the parent function, and the blue graph represents the kid function, right? If you took out a picture of my kids, they look like me. Some people call these the mother function. And when you click on that, it says set A equals 0, A equals 1, B equals 1, C equals 1. We're going to call this the default. So anytime I say reset it to default, A, B, and C are both 1. Go ahead and do that, and then see if you guys can answer these couple of questions, and then we'll go over that together. All right, we just went over the Explore. Let's go ahead and go over some vocab. A function with with an equation of the form y equals ax squared plus bx plus c, where a is not equal to 0. This is called a quadratic function. the line, so let's draw a graph here, that might help. This is my graph. And this is my quadratic function. Let's draw something like this. Let's change that to red. Okay, quadratic function. Okay, my next one is the line about which the graph is symmetric. They call this one the axis or line of symmetry. Now, sometimes people will abbreviate it as AOS. Axis of symmetry or line of symmetry. And this is the green dot here. Back in geometry, we would have said something like a angle or segment bisector. It cuts it in half. Okay, let's go purple here. Either the lowest point, which we call the minimum, like that, or min for short, or the highest point, which is also called the maximum, on a parabola, this is called the vertex. Okay, so let me go ahead and locate the vertex on ours. Okay, now pay attention. The vertex, let's say this is a skateboard ramp, it's the minimum in our graph because it's pointing up, but I also want you to notice that actually the axis or line of symmetry goes through, it goes through the vertex. So they actually have the same x value. Okay. How a quantity is changing with respect to a change in another quantity. This is called rate of change. Rate of change. And then the last one, change different color here. The change in the value of the dependent variable divided by the change in the value of the independent variable, this is called the average rate of change, which we're going to learn later on. Okay. Let's do a couple of things here. Okay, here, this whole term here in orange, they call this the quadratic form. Sorry, I'm so zoomed in, it's gonna be pixelated. Quadratic term. This green one here is called the linear term. Why is this linear? Is because x is to the first power right here, it's invisible. Quadratic term because it has the power of 2, and then this one that has no x, this is called the constant. Now, I do want to bring up some previous knowledge. You learned back at linears y equals mx plus b. And what's confusing is that b was the y-intercept. Now, the y-intercept is the c in quadratics. M was the slope that's in front of x, but just to the first power. But I just want you not to confuse the b values. Okay, let's use the vocabulary words to kind of get some formulas here. The axis of symmetry, or the line of symmetry, I'm going to call it AOS. Here, formula is x equals negative. Okay, I like to draw my fractions up and down. The negative sign is in the same line as a fraction. I'm going to write b over 2a. Sounds like the beginning of a song. X equals negative b all over 2. Wait, I know, you don't like what I'm singing. Okay. What color do we use for the y-intercept? Okay, so the c value, which we talked here in blue, this is also your y-intercept. So that is here, y-intercept. It's where it crosses the y-axis, right? That's the x. And one last thing that I want to point out, which is kind of cool. Yes, math is cool. is this line here. And if you go from the dark blue to the green, this distance is equal to this distance, right? And so they just call this a reflection of the y-intercept. Okay, so that is our vocab. Let's go ahead and move on now to 1.11.
The new all-purpose Inkman has arrived with all your favorite catchphrases like
"It's time for game plans!"
and capable of doing anything you need.
I use mine as a bookmark.
I use him to help teach my class.
It's time for game plans!
And for a limited time offer, you can get yourself a silly man too.